In this video, we're going to be taking a look at estimating mu when sigma is unknown. So here what we're looking at is we want to estimate the population mean when the population standard deviation is unknown. And that's actually a pretty likely scenario. It wouldn't necessarily be the case that you would not know the population mean, but you would know the population standard deviation. Usually, when you're doing research, both of these are unknown to you. And so you'll be trying to estimate the population mean, but you won't have a value for the population standard deviation. And the conditions for inference here for creating a confidence interval are pretty much the same as they were when we knew sigma. We still need a simple random sample. Our data need to come from a simple random sample. Here, though, we need sigma to be unknown with the method that we're going to talk about. And then we still need the problem to say something about x follows a roughly normal distribution. And here, when sigma is unknown, it can actually be quite rough. It's enough for it to just be mound-shaped and symmetric. It doesn't have to be precisely normal or super close to normal, because the distribution that we use to calculate the confidence interval for mu when sigma is unknown is actually called the T distribution. And it's not as strict as the normal. It's still mound-shaped and symmetric, but it doesn't have the same strict criteria that the normal distribution does. So X needs to follow a roughly normal distribution, or just be mound-shaped and symmetric, or we've got to have those sample sizes of 30 or more. If we have large enough sample sizes, we don't even need to worry about this. And again, the whole point of this criteria is to ensure that X bar follows a roughly T-shaped distribution, rather than the normal here. Because again, the calculations that we're going to use here are based on something called the student's T distribution rather than the normal distribution. Now, if we were going to do this by hand, the process is essentially exactly the same as the process was for calculating a confidence interval for mu when we knew sigma, but the formula changes a little bit. We still start with X bar as our best guess, or our best estimate of the population mean, and we still add and subtract our margin of error. But when we don't know sigma, our margin of error calculations are different, because our margin of error calculations before, we had z sub c times sigma over the square root of n, and obviously if we don't know sigma, this has got to change a little bit. So what it becomes here is x bar plus or minus t sub c, the critical value of t rather than the critical value of z. And instead of sigma over root n, it's s over the square root of n, where s is the sample standard deviation. So in place of the population standard deviation, which we don't know, we're going to use the sample standard deviation instead, and that also means that we're forced to use a student's T distribution rather than the normal to approximate the distribution of X bar here. Now, this T sub C can be found in your book using a table. It's a table in the back of the book, actually. It's one of the appendices. There is a T table. That being said, again, most people probably aren't going to do this by hand. It's by far more common to do this either with a calculator or some type of software. So if we're going to use the calculator, when sigma was known and we wanted to estimate mu, we used the z interval. And we used the z because when sigma was known, this was all based on a normal distribution. Now that sigma is unknown, we'll use what's called the t interval. So that is for calculating mu when sigma is unknown. And again, the calculator knows if you select the t interval that this is going to be based on the t distribution. And so you don't have to look this up by hand. It'll be programmed into the calculator program that it's going to be using. Okay, but we do still have to check our conditions for inference first. So we'll check those. Then we'll put everything into the calculator and we'll be able to get and interpret our interval just like we did before. The basic confidence interval process is the same. It's just the interval that we use that changes. And you'll find that that's true throughout this entire chapter. Basically, anytime we're doing confidence intervals, the process is basically the same. It's just we're using different intervals each time. So here's an example with some tree ring data from an archaeological site. And we have years in AD. For an excavation site. And then assume X follows a normal distribution. So that was stated. And then here are the years that we have. We have a tree that dates to 1189 by tree ring dating, one that's 1271, 1267, 1272, 1268, 1316, 1275, 1317, and another 1275. Okay, so there's our tree ring data. And what we're supposed to do is find and interpret a 90% CI, or confidence interval. You'll see me abbreviate it a lot as CI. So find and interpret a 90% confidence interval for the mean of all tree ring dates from this archaeological site. Okay, we just had a sample, right? We had a sample of what, 2, 4, 6, 8, 9. We had a sample of 9 different trees. We want to find the mean of all tree ring dates, or we want to use, the sample data to estimate the mean of all of them. Obviously, it doesn't make any sense for us to cut into all the trees, find the tree ring data, and do all of that. That would not be a productive use of our time or resources. So instead, we took a random sample. Oh yeah, this was a simple random sample. Okay, we took a simple random sample of trees. We sampled 9 trees. We want to use that sample to estimate the mean of all tree ring dates. Okay, so we can see we're calculating a confidence interval, and we have our confidence level there. The first thing that we need to do is we need to check our conditions for inference. And again, those were, did we have a simple random sample? Did it say something about normally distributed or mound-shaped and symmetric, or n greater than equal to 30? And then also, to use the method that we're talking about today, sigma needs to be unknown. We did have a simple random sample. It's said to assume that the tree ring dates were normally distributed, which is good because we didn't have a big enough sample size. But since this is an or, being normally distributed is good enough. And then here the sigma was unknown. So because all of our conditions are met, we can use the t interval in the calculator to calculate the estimate for our mean population mean tree ring date. Okay. So here's how this will work. First thing, because we've been given data here rather than summary statistics, we actually need to put those pieces of data into the calculator. So we'll need to go into Stat and Edit. If you have stuff in there, you'll want to clear it out. And then we're going to put those tree ring dates in here. So we had 1189, 1271, 1267, 1272, 1268, 1316, 1275, 1317, and another 1275. Okay, so that's what we had for our tree ring dates. Then, where we'll want to go is the same place that we went to find the z-interval. We go to Stat, use the right arrow key to scroll all the way to over to the right to the Tests menu, and then we need to scroll down until we see the ones that say interval at the end. And there's z-interval, that's the one that we used when sigma was known. Here's t-interval, the one that we use when sigma is unknown. So we select t-interval. Then the calculator asks us, do we have data or do we have stats? We actually have data here, so we'll want to select that. When the calculator says list, it's asking you in which list your data are stored. Mine are in L1, so I'll want to do second one to get my L1 to pop up. If yours were in list 5, you would do second 5. Okay. Frequency should be set to 1. And then we get to put in our confidence level, which in this case we are finding a 90% confidence interval for the tree ring data. And when you have all of that put in, then you'll just calculate. And it'll crunch through for a minute. And there's our interval at the top. The year's about 1249 to 1295, roughly, if we're rounding to the nearest whole year. So we used T interval in the calculator. The interval that we got out was 1249 to 1295. And then when we interpret that piece, again, our interpretation really should have three chunks. The first chunk, you talk about how confident you were. So we are 90% confident that. Then you talk about what it was that you estimated. And what we were estimating was the mean of all tree ring dates from this archaeological site. So we are 90% confident that the mean of all tree ring dates from this archaeological site and then you talk about what your endpoints were, is between 1249 AD and 1295 AD. If there are units associated with your interval, you should include these in your description. Here we were looking at dates in AD, so we want to put AD there. If we had done something and these were in feet or degrees Celsius or whatever it was, you would want to include those units as part of your interpretation. Okay, but this helps people who don't have a stats background take this interval and put it into its proper context. We're pretty sure that if we were to look at all the tree ring dates in this site, the year, the mean year of those trees would fall between 1249 and 1295.